Hello and welcome to Adrian's Chemistry Laboratory. Someone commented in one of the comments, in quite a rant actually, about the quality of modern chemistry sets and how they contain nothing really, really exciting or nothing really actually dangerous. And I thought I would really deal with this because what I have with me is a replica of really my very first ever chemistry set. As you can see, it's been eaten away here. Now, this is not the exact chemistry set. I'm actually just looking through it today for the video. I discovered it's one that doesn't contain just as many chemicals as my chemistry set had. It's called set 2. I think I had a set 3. And it had a picture of a wonderful man called Johnny Ball. He's the father of the BBC Radio 1 DJ Zoe Ball. And he used to do a great programme on the BBC called Think of a Number and Think Again. I wish they would bring them back. They were really, really good fun. Especially remember the one about explosives. Now, this is, as I said, basically what I had as my first chemistry set when I was 11. I'm now 47. This is of the same sort of period. One of the little bottles here has sort of just disappeared. It's eaten away at the cardboard there because it was sodium hydrogen sulfate. And I think it's decomposed into sulfuric acid and has begun to eat away at everything, so we've removed it. But it contains all the chemicals that I had. I think I had just a couple more chemicals and a little bit more equipment. I did have a glass U-tube, which this one doesn't have, and carbon rods to do electrolysis. And I remember my father and I doing some electrolysis on some salt solution, just normal common salt, and nearly poisoning ourselves with chlorine gas. Which of course anyone can do with a 9-volt battery still. But it contains methyl orange, copper sulfate, iron filings, iron sulfate, ichrome black, even a very modern ion exchange resin, charcoal, tartaric acid, sodium carbonate and magnesium sulfate. And I think this one said before the label fell off it was calcium hydroxide, which is quite corrosive in itself, especially if you get it into your eyes. But I had the most fun ever with this, and it also came with a Salters little cassette tape and a pair of goggles, which I don't know whether I'll have a go anyway. Yes, this is what I would have looked like without the beard. But you'll be able to look back in my YouTube videos and see a history of my laboratories. And I'm now on my, I think, 11th, maybe my 12th. There's still one in France to show you. And unfortunately, all my laboratories have been ruined by other people. And this small laboratory that I'm in at the minute is a temporary laboratory. So hopefully nobody will destroy it. But you can see in some of the videos there that the big laboratory that I had was destroyed by robbers who came in and helped themselves to an awful lot of things. I was very, very lucky that I saw them selling some of the bottles on eBay about a year and a half later. And I went down to a very strange and dodgy place with an Alsatian tied up to it and pretended I was a buyer for a pub and was able to acquire back some of my bottles, which was lovely to see because they hadn't destroyed them and they didn't know what they were selling themselves and had kept the contents in them. So it was nice to see old friends coming back to me. So I got about 60% of all that was sort of had been stolen. Now what I wanted to do was to challenge you those people that said that chemistry sets were really, really boring and didn't contain anything dangerous, and thought that maybe just from this very simple chemistry set and adding possibly a couple of very other unnoxious chemicals to them, we could possibly make something dangerous. Because I see here we've got an azo dye, so we've got unstable, as it were, nitrogen links that we could milk into with methyl orange. We've got copper sulfate, and I see that the Salters chemistry set here allows you to buy, or you could get another set that contained ammonium chloride. And again, we could mess around with the nitrogen atoms and link them to copper, and that could form a very unstable compound. But what I thought I would do today is simply take some of this iron sulfate, and we're going to then mix it with some sodium carbonate to make iron carbonate. And then what we're going to do is we're going to dissolve the iron carbonate in the tartaric acid. And from that, we are going to have iron tartrate. And I know that if that's heated up in a test tube, we can produce a very dangerous, spontaneously flammable form of iron. And we're going to go and do that now. Now, of course, in my first chemistry set by Salters, and I'm guessing I say it was a number 3 because it had cobalt chloride in it, and I think some zinc as well, which this one doesn't. And it was a later addition because it was promoted by a man called Johnny Ball. The equipment was very limited. You had one heatable test tube, one borosilicate glass test tube. The rest of them actually had a label on them saying do not heat, so they were soda glass, and they're really what you used all the time. Now, I would have been just over the moon if I had even been supplied with a little beaker. This is a 50ml beaker and it has the name Pyrex on it. This would have been an absolute gem to me. And I remember getting my very first 50ml beaker, and it wasn't graduated, and it was from a chemistry set called Merit that I discovered in England, in Plymouth. And there was a toy shop there that sold some of the chemistry set stuff. And I was absolutely thrilled. It was like sending me into one of those firework warehouses in America that you get, which I've still to go to. I do remember my very famous, my very favourite chemistry teacher was called Mr. Graham, Mr. Lawrence Graham. And he was my first year teacher at the high school I went to. And he was a lovely, lovely fella. A gentleman with white hair, and he inspired me very much in first year, and I asked him, I remember, could I get a conical flask? And again, to me, this was like a gold bar. And he was very, very kind, and he went and got me this lovely little Pyrex Elmware flask, conical flask, which, and this is the original one, so I don't want to use it or break it. And the other piece, just bizarrely, of equipment that was very special to me, was this little extraction flask. There was a school closing down called Mount Collier School. And on the stage, they had a ginormous basket, a basket you would see in an opera or that they would use at the back of the stage. And it was crammed full of quick fit glassware and other bits and pieces. And at the time, I think it was being auctioned off for about £80, and that might as well have been £8,000 to us back then. And I remember my mum squatting down as we were looking at it, and I was really hoping that they were going to put a bid in, and unfortunately they couldn't afford it, and she pinched one of these. And it's very, very special because I had never seen one. I mean, if I'd been able to get a one of these boiling flasks, which I used to look at and dream at in the Davison Hardy Griffin and Tatlock catalogue, it would have just been everything I ever wanted, believe it or not. And the bizarre thing is, with all the equipment that I have in this laboratory, I very, very rarely use these boiling flasks, and yet these seem to be antiphonal. You would see them in setups for what chemists use all the time, when in fact we don't. Chemistry, unfortunately for me, sometimes has become so automated and computerized, it's quite boring in modern laboratories. It is amazing what they can do, but it's quite boring. Now, I don't want to bore you, so I'm going to get on with some of this experiment. What we're going to do is we're going to produce some iron carbonate first of all, and then I'll talk you along the process of what we're doing with that. Now, for the sake of authenticity, I thought we'd actually use the chemicals that we've got in the chemistry set. I could use the small test tubes, but actually, to be honest, I think it's going to be easier if we use beakers and things. It'll be less fiddly. So that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to just take some of this iron sulfate and put it into a beaker. And I've got a little test tube of water, and we're going to make a strong solution of iron to sulfate. And now I'm going to use this little extraction flask that I was talking about that's so special to me. And I've just made a rather strong solution of sodium carbonate. We're going to add that to the iron 2 sulfate, when we should produce then iron carbonate in a precipitate.
And I suspect that that will get eventually to iron hydroxide, which of course then we'll be able to filter off, and then we're going to dissolve that in our tartaric acid. And so now we're going to add the solutions together. Now I don't know which one will appear more dramatic, so I'm going to try adding the iron 2 sulfate to the sodium carbonate solution, and there we do, we get a horrible yellow sort of green sludge of a precipitate. There we are. Now you're going to filter that off, and of course as a little boy of 11, if I had the filtering device that I have now, which is a Buechner funnel, I would think I was in Disney World. And again, to have such quality and numerous filter papers was a very rare event. When you had a chemistry set, you had to be very, very economical with the amount of filter paper that you used. So we've just got a Buechner funnel here, set it up to the little filter pump at the sink, and we're going to then start filtering off our precipitate, very sludgy precipitate, as you can see, lovely sort of dove grey colour of iron carbonate. There it is. I'm going to let that filter in. Now it's probably going to take quite some time because it's a very sludgy precipitate. And so we have our precipitate here, which I'm going to just scrape off the filter paper. As you can see, it's beginning to darken as it gets oxidized. And we're going to just take this wet sludge of our precipitate and put it into this little beaker of tartaric acid, which is kindly supplied by Salter's chemistry set. We're just going to give it a little stir, get as much as we can, and then we're going to hopefully see it all dissolve away and form, there's fizzing, so we're getting carbon dioxide from the iron carbonate that was formed. And we're forming iron tartate, which we're going to then put into a little evaporating basin, which I again would have been delighted to have with the chemistry set, and to then evaporate the salt down. And then I'll take you further along the stage of what we're going to do to that. So we'll just let that sit and dissolve. And so goes in the last amount of iron tartate, and all we're going to do is take a Bunsen burner, and of course if we had a chemistry set, which we do, but it would take a lot longer, we'd be using a little spirit burner. And what we're going to do is just allow the water to evaporate, and we should be left with a crystalline salt of iron tartate. Now what we're going to do is take our sludgy residue, which is basically just the iron tartate, and I've poured it into this little tiny test tube. We're going to gently heat it to try and drive off some of the water. I'm going to have to be very careful so that it doesn't jump out of the test tube, because steam will try and push out all the contents of the test tube. So we're going to just do it, play around the flame, get it to dry off, and then we're going to heat it up really, really, really hard to a red heat, and hopefully produce iron, which will have a very interesting property. So now we're going to heat it up to red heat and drive off all, not just the moisture that is contained in the solution, but also molecular water that's contained in the iron tartate. And we should be left with just pure iron, but iron in a very, very highly divided state. This is beginning to carbonize there, and the laboratory is filling full of nasty fumes, which of course, if you're doing this at home with a small chemistry set, your mother, like mine, might just kick you out of the house and you end up in a shed. So So we're going to heat this up, and then what we're going to do is we're going to just plug the top of it so that no air can get in. And I'm going to prove to you that just from three very simple, harmless, innocuous chemicals in a chemistry set, we can produce something which is quite dangerous, actually. So I'm just going to plug this with a little cotton wool of on the top so that air doesn't get in, and then I'm going to show you what's going to happen afterwards. So here's the test tube here, which we have heated up the sludge, which should turn to a nice black powder, all being well. I'm just giving it a bit of a poke here. Hopefully it'll come out of our test tube. And we should have formed a spontaneously flammable. Yes, there we are. We've got sparks, shards of sparks. Look at that. Spontaneously flammable iron, pyrophoric iron. Simply because the iron has become highly finely divided and is very, very reactive and incandescent in the... So you can only get it on anything. Look, it's even got... It's even catching the cotton wool there on fire. Now, that just shows you that you can produce something rather dangerous from three innocuous substances found in a solder's chemistry set. Iron sulfate, sodium carbonate, and tartaric acid. So, mums and dads, watch out and always supervise. Now, it's really interesting here that... Take off these little terrible goggles because I look like Captain Chemistry. That the little instruction manual called Getting Into Chemistry doesn't actually do the experiment that we just did. And I wonder why. But I'll put these three very dangerous chemicals back into their safe place in the chemistry set of tartaric acid, of iron sulfate, and some sodium carbonate. And out of them, as you know, if you mix all three of them together, you can make spontaneously flammable iron. Now, some other exciting experiments I'm going to show you later on are from the chemical books that I used as a boy. They were really my standard chemistry books that I used in my laboratory. This is Page's book of chemical experiments by R.H. Waring. He also did a wonderful little book on biology as well. But some great illustrations, and again, it's one of those things that shows you how to set up your own home chemistry laboratory, and some really good experiments and fun. And they even, of course, use saltpeter an awful lot. And of course, I've mentioned this one in the past, is Chemistry Experiments by A. Kemper. Here we see a lovely illustration of bromine reacting with aluminium, not something you want to try inside. If you look at one of my previous YouTube videos, you'll be able to see that being done on a bucket scale outside. So thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed that, and please like and subscribe.
Just a perfect day. Feed animals in the zoo. Then later, a movie too, and then home. Oh, it's such a perfect day. I'm glad I spent it with you. Oh, such a perfect day.